Awesome. See a little bit of what's coming there. Okay, great. Yeah, so listen, for this class, you might also want to access the handout. We'll probably refer to it a little bit later in the talk. And so the handout is my analysis of a piece by Anton Webern. So if you have that handy, just keep it aside, keep it next by, and we'll probably refer to it a little bit as the class goes forward. You can consider today's class as a look at some general strategies when analyzing music. The focus is on pitch analysis, but I think you'll find that some of these strategies are useful and applicable to analyzing all different types of music. So not just pitch, but we're gonna think in terms of pitch because that's how we're starting the course. And so let's move forward then. My first slide, which you already saw. So this is about the features of tonal music. Maybe some of you know these or have seen these musicians. It's called they're known as the Axis of Awesome. Have you watched any of their videos by chance? The Axis of Awesome. Catch them on YouTube certainly. They talk about how a set of standard chords is often used in popular music. A certain progression being a 1-5, a 6 chord, sorry, a 1-5, a 4, and then a 6 chord, and then returning to 1. It's a com they're a comedy routine, so it's quite comical seeing how they deal with standard tonal music progression. But I'm starting with this just to remind us a little bit of a pitch analysis, what a pitch analysis usually results in when we're dealing with tonal music. So through pitch analysis, we can usually define a mode or maybe a scale, we can say. So typically in tonal music, it's major or minor. Tonal music often is built on triads, and this triad, of course, becomes how we define kind of the central harmonic unit at each point in the composition. We know that there's kind of fundamental chords, 1 and 5 being kind of the primary ones, and that we're looking for this interaction between 1 and 5. We know that there's also strong directional and tonal motion that really is about focusing the melody and the bass motion. So bass and melody are really part of giving us direction, and they're following, you know, again, the triads, that tonal structure that the triads are outlining. We know there's a close relationship between harmonic and rhythmic organization, also between tonal and phrase structure. And then, of course, my last point there that we talk about cadences, and those cadences are codified in tonal music in a very, very clear way. These, just a quick aside, these slides are on the course website, so if you want to scoot a look back at them in an upcoming week, feel free, of course. Have I missed anything? Is this a pretty good generalization of things that you analyze in tonal music, especially when we're talking about pitch? I'm also asking myself if I missed anything. I mean, one thing that's missing here perhaps is I mentioned like 1-5-1, but I don't speak a lot about here about this kind of play of consonants and then dissonance and then resolution. Or, you know, in classical music, the notion that you move from a very consonant is not the right word, excuse me. You move from a tonic, a tonal center, and you move to a different key even, and it's that key that is quite can be quite far away, especially as you get into more romantic music. And though there's always that return to a one tonality, so there's this resolution that's always really implied in tonal music as well. That's really, really important that we return to where we started, which is yeah, kind of a funny thing to think that we always need to return home in tonal music. Why do we need to return home all the time? But anyway, that's there you go. So that's just a little bit of a thought review of what a pitch analysis might entail in tonal music. However, what if you get a piece like this? I'm actually going to play a short extract. You're looking at 10 measures of a composition. This is actually, if you've got your hand out, you probably realize this is the first 10 measures of the quartet by Webern. And I'm going to play it for you in a second. However, before we do that, I wanted to ask you a few questions. When you analyze music and this music in particular, we'll use this as an example, you're presented with the score. Maybe you've never heard it before, but my question for you, what can you do with this before listening to the actual music to start to even begin to analyze what you have in front of you? Give me some ideas. What, you've got the score, you haven't listened to it yet, you're being asked to analyze this. What sort of things might you do with the score? You're going to read it, obviously. But what strikes you as perhaps things here that you would be looking for if your goal is to analyze? Give me some ideas, if I could ask. I can kick it off if you like. I mean, we just talked about tonal music. I guess one might start to look for triads, right? In tonal music, we often look towards even the first measure to see if there's a key signature. That's usually a pretty good hint to know what the first triad might be.
The one that comes with like chromatic music, there's the key signature doesn't exactly help because there's going to be so many accidentals popping out everywhere that the key signature almost doesn't help.
Yeah, and when you look at this, Patrick, have you noticed all the accidentals?
Yes.
Yeah. So yeah, that's a good sign that maybe chromaticism, but probably more importantly, the notion of conforming to one key center at any one time is not going to be true. There's going to be some kind of shifting. If there's key in this at all, if there's a tonality in this at all, it's going to be shifting. That's a question. Or maybe it's chromatic. Great, yeah, I like that. So accidentals, looking at different, that's really clear right away. Like, look, almost every note has an accidental. Like, what the heck? That's bizarre. What other things that you might look at to help you with that initial analysis?
Well, maybe just as a musician, you want to just look in advance the intervals that's going to be coming up, so you can prepare for it, in a sense, I guess.
Yeah, nice. So that's a bit of a deeper dive. You're going to dig in and actually try to read some of the intervals. I suppose that's where you might be thinking about, well, are there any triads in here? Let's see if those intervals meet. I will give you a little hint. There's a lot of 0-1-4 in this. Again, don't be alarmed if you don't see that yet. That's going to be our job in the next couple of classes. But there is some consistent interval relations, even in these 10 measures. Actually, significant relations. And perhaps you'd see that just by reading the score. I think you can. You've all had enough experience, you know, reading materials, reading a score, and you could probably start to calculate these intervals right out of the gate. What about instruments? Look to see what instruments, how many voices. This is obviously German. We got this as a score from Webern, and he's written words in German. The top line is the violin, the Geige, I think we say, if I say that right. Violin, clarinet, tenor saxophone, and of course piano. We recognize even just from the staff lines. So that's huge, right? In your analysis, even begin with the basics, right? How many voices? What instruments are they? Another big one that I think you could start to identify with the experience and knowledge you have is the idea of texture. even in these 10 measures, what would you say if, and we haven't defined texture, I hope maybe you have an understanding already of what texture means, but when you look at this, how would you describe the texture just by looking at the score? Tanner, did you have some ideas maybe?
I'm trying to think of the right word. I would think of something more like, it doesn't seem very full.
Yeah.
Something like that.
Yeah, that's huge. That's a really, really important point. Keep, and by the way, as we're identifying these features, the point is then when we listen to it, that, you know, we're already tuned into what the music actually might sound like. So great point, Tanner, not very full. Does anyone have a word for that? Maybe if we, could we give it a word? There's a word we could use. It might be a new word. We often refer to this texture as pointillistic or pointillism. Again, drawing from perhaps from the visual arts, we could say. But yeah, it's not just that it's not very full, but if you look for, say, simultaneities from top to bottom, meaning chords, there doesn't appear to be a lot of chords. It looks that there's occasionally a note or two will line up, but rarely. So there looks to be occasionally some overlapping between two or three notes. So that's also going to contribute to this kind of sparse, not very full texture, pointillistic texture. However, you've seen the second system, measure six there, and we have, remember the third line down is the saxophone. Something happens really interestingly there at measure six, where the saxophone almost seems to have a continuous line. There's lots of rests between every time the saxophone plays, but compared to the first five measures, this is actually a pretty major shift, that suddenly the saxophone almost starts to have a continuity, playing from nonstop. So measure six, we might say there's maybe hints of a different sort of texture here. What's the word we use when we have melody and accompaniment? So a texture that, you know, one instrument has the main theme, the foreground melody, and then other instruments support it harmonically, maybe rhythmically, a bass line. What texture, do you remember what word we use for that?
Would it just be
heterophony? No. Heterophony is really close to the idea of polyphony, where voices show a lot more independence, but also at the same time similarity. It's not a bad guess, though, Patrick, especially because of this piece. It does look, in a way, like even though every instrument only plays, you know, two notes at a time, sometimes three notes, they seem to be parallel somehow in the other voices. So hang on to that idea. No, but, you know, the standard texture, which again is, you know, predominantly all pop music as well, that's homophonic music, right? Homophony, where there's a melody and then some chordal accompaniment normally, bass and rhythm. This isn't pure homophony. Obviously, there's no chords still, but there's at least a suggestion of it, because the saxophone takes over, seems to have a more predominant line, and the other voices start to kick in, and they seem to be synchronized a little bit better. You know, the top lines, the violin, clarinet seem to be sharing a similar idea. The piano, left hand and right hand, seem to be sharing a similar idea. So a hint, maybe a hint of homophony. Okay, so we've got, just going back, we've identified that, yeah, there's no key signature, lots of accidentals. We were starting to maybe consider looking at intervals, seeing if there's any triads. We've even done some basic things like what instruments are playing, what sort of textures are involved here. Let me go a little bit further. Even looking at a score, you may start to detect phrase structure, or important beginnings, or maybe important cadences or endings. When you look at this, these 10 measures, do you see anything that you think might be significant for indicating, you know, the first section or the second section or a cadential type structure? Anything that catches your attention? again, just looking at the notation itself.
And the repeat measure line there, would be separating the two sections?
Yeah, that's huge. That's huge. Then combined with the retardando marking and then add tempo. So we're saying that between measure 5 and measure 6, well, something's happening here, right? Because Webern's started his, as Patrick said, he's indicated that there's going to be a repetition coming up. So I might then, as analyzing this without listening to it yet, I might just take note of what the piano is doing and think, well, this looks like maybe it's an ending of some sort. Maybe there's going to be a similar approach later in the composition. I also note that piano gesture is intriguing, perhaps in a way that the left hand and the right hand are moving in contrary motion. There's a two-note overlap. I don't know if there's, in this little extract, if we see any point where there's two notes overlapping. It's mostly single notes overlapping. Does that make sense what I'm saying? So I'm looking at the piano, measure 5. You get it? Okay, so maybe there's some instance of termination and then a new beginning. That's really key. Other basic things you can always look for even things like words, titles of compositions. You notice the beginning there is in German, Sehr mäßig, in German, which means at a very moderate speed. Mit Dämpfer, just below that, that's telling the violin player to use a mute. You probably recognize the words for violin, pizzicato, arco, so moving from plucking to regular bowing. These are all really, really key ingredients that you're going to want to watch for and see if they're being used in other forms and other sections. The last thing I'll say, and then we'll move on, I'll listen to it, the dynamics. Look at the dynamics as well and see if there's any consistency. I'm noticing, for example, the forte piano that begins the piece, also used in the piano, perhaps maybe giving that the piano gestures a little bit more impact. So these are all things that you can do right in your analysis, even before listening. Take some time with the score and it can be really revealing. Okay, so I'm going to play it for you a little bit here. It's just the first 10 measures or so. And remember my question was, we got this, we got these rules for analyzing tonal music, but what if the music sounds very different like this? I hope you can hear it. Here we go. Did that come through at your end? Yeah? I'm going to play it one more.
It was just very quiet, sorry.
You're in a loud environment too, aren't you? Pretty loud environment.
Mm-hmm, I guess. It's just, it's a bit quieter compared to your voice.
Okay. Give me a second. I'm just going to try to bump it up a little bit. I want to play it one more time for you as well. So I'm going to turn that music up just a little bit. And keep that in your mind, what you just heard. And just to renew my share screen, I want to make sure you're seeing it again. Here we go. Let's see. Oops. Go away. Stop that. Oh. And what I'll ask you to focus on the second time. Can you see that now? You're seeing the whole shebang. Okay, give me a second. Well, just to give you a better resolution, let me see if I can pick the actual. Okay, what are you seeing at your end? Are you seeing this slideshow now again? Super, thank you. Okay, what I'm gonna ask you to do is see if you can focus in on one voice. You can choose, but I might suggest the saxophone. And especially when you get to measure six, see if you can hear what the saxophone's doing. Here we go. Yeah, it's a very quiet piece. My recording is also super quiet. What are your thoughts? Was anyone do you hear the pointillistic texture? Is that a fair description of what you heard? And thanks. And did you get a sense of the ending beginning measure 5 to 6? I don't know if you felt that shift, that transition. This is also, again, part of the interesting challenges of listening to atonal music and trying to be open to other ways, right? There's no cadence at measure 5, but there's definitely a feeling of closure there. The contrary motion of the piano helps. This kind of slow beginning ritardando 6 into a tempo, and the saxophone then, again, not playing every moment, but certainly more often and more continuously, really gives a sense of a new beginning at measure 6. Let's move on, because there's a few general points too that I want to get to today. And so there you go. It's a quartet, opus 22, from 1930 by Anton Webern. And does everyone see that? You just see my slides, right? You don't see the full desktop, you see the whole slide. Okay, super, thank you. Yeah, and this is in our listening list as well, and of course you have now a score, which is a full analysis of this piece. And so my next slide I have here just as an example of the analysis. Again, if you've pulled this off of the Moodle site, you'll have it there close by, but I've got it here projected as a slide. And I think it's interesting to again take a quick moment with this just to see. We're not going to do a thorough look at this. I just basically, my goal here was to give you an illustration of what I'll be looking for in your first assignment. So your first assignment is going to be an analysis of some atonal music, and this is the sort of thing I'm going to expect. So, for example, you're noticing color, you're noticing certain notes are boxed, certain groups of notes are boxed and given a specific color. You see there the first measure, tenor saxophone, you might see 014 in parentheses. So I'll be asking you to identify sets, 014. Again, if you don't see how that's a 014, don't worry too much about it. That's what we're going to be dealing with in the coming classes. You'll also notice again the saxophone line. I've given numbers to every note, 1, 2, 3, with the little that little accent or hat on top of the number. We often use that in tonal music, right, to refer to a scale degree. I'm guessing you've seen that in your other classes. So one with a hat would be, scale degree 1 of that particular scale. In this case, we use it to identify the 12 tones of a 12-tone row. So if you just follow the blue numbers, so 1, 2, 3, tenor saxophone, then I see in the piano right hand, 4, 5, 6, blue numbers. Moving forward, the next measure back to the saxophone, 7, 8. Clarinet, 9, and then finally measure 5, the piano, the right hand, 10, 11, 12. If you're following along and maybe you're catching this quickly enough, you'll see that actually those 12 notes are the 12 notes of our tempered tuning, our tempered scale system. So not only is this piece about little sets, like 0, 1, 4, little collections of notes. But this piece is also a 12-tone piece, where Webern has really constructed the piece such that each note of the chromatic scale is presented before it's repeated. You'll also notice the green numbers, 1, 2, 3, starting in the violin. And so this is actually another 12-tone row. So obviously the same pitches, because every 12-tone row has the same pitches, but in a different order. So this is a really interesting construction where, again, you've got different collections called sets, but you've also, Webern's also employed two different sequences of notes, each one, again, conveying all 12 notes of the chromatic scale. And just confirming what we said about measure 5, measure 5, the piano, we have these 12-tone rows, the last three notes being played, 10, 11, 12 in the right hand, of course, and 10, 11, 12 of the green in the left. And that really helps us to confirm, actually, that that's a very important point in this composition. Before we begin measure 6, where we then have, in fact, three different 12-tone rows. We've got the saxophone outlining one specific row. We have then the piano kicking off another one in the right hand and another one in the left. And so really interesting piece that we are going to dig into this piece a little bit more, but I'm just trying to give examples of the sorts of things I'm going to be looking for in your analysis. So how are these notes grouped together? Do they form sets? Perhaps the piece I'll give you will also be a 12-tone piece, and you'll literally have to count the notes and try to find the correct sequence. Don't be too alarmed. In these assignments, I'll be giving you lots of hints just to help you kind of move you along. At least once you get started and you start to see the patterns and how they're organized, usually it becomes quite easy and clear to see how the composers organize these pitches. Does that make sense so far? Do you have any comments or questions? Does it make sense what I'm saying? And again, you can look at this after class, or you know, in the meantime, before our next class, and verify what I'm saying. Does anyone see how like the first tenor sax gesture is a 0-1-4? Does that make sense that we call it a 0-1-4? So if this is a 0-1-4, what is the zero referring to? I have to do it myself. Let me see. Right, got it. Yeah.
Do you mean for the first clarinet line and first measure?
So first measure, Patrick, but the tenor saxophone. So it's the third line down. It's a brown box. The notes are D flat, B flat, and then there's a leap down to a low A. And I'm calling that a 0-1-4. This is not a D 0-1-4. This is another type of 0-1-4. Does anyone see the starting pitch, what it would be? If you don't get it, that's okay, because that's the subject of tomorrow's class. But I was curious if anyone caught it.
The 0 would be the A.
Absolutely, yeah. So remember 0-1-4, that's a minor second and then also a major third. And so the A up a minor second gets us our B flat, and then an A, a major third, gets us the C sharp, which here is spelled as a D flat. It's not in the same, like it's not in the order of 0-1-4, so it's not expressed A, B flat, D flat. It's mixed up. But that's fair game in set theory. Okay, so let's move on. I have a couple more slides to get through, and we'll be returning to this piece in the coming class. It's a really, really awesome piece, really constructed well. Okay, so take a step back here. You're doing an analysis. Again, some of these ideas you could use for any type of piece, but I'm really asking you to consider them for atonal music. The what we did on the right, we've already talked about this. With the score, you got the score, haven't listened to it yet, but you should be able to do things like look at the length of the piece, count how many measures. You'll find that in atonal music, just like tonal music, there's usually some symmetry in terms of measures, right? Maybe it's going to be blocks of 8, blocks of four, which is quite common in tonal music, you're going to find those same lengths in atonal music. Instrumentation, texture, we talked about. Guess, you want to guess maybe where some of the structural points are. Look at the titles, the words, look at the date of the composition. If you know something about the composer, the historical context, that can be really fruitful. That takes us back to the discussion on last class where we talked about a real analysis and this idea of ontogenesis and phylogenesis, right? That the date and composition might actually give you some hints about the composer and where they were at that point in the career, or whether the composition falls into, say, the second Viennese school, which is the case here. And that may inform your analysis. The section on the left-hand side, so now I'm just going to listen to it without the score. And these are all things you can try to do, just listening. And it can be really fruitful to listen in this way. So actually using your ears to try to determine where the piece seems to begin and end, listening for things that seem like cadences, things that maybe begin anew, afresh. Density. So I think tenor, even without the score, we probably would have called this, you know, a pointillistic, or it seems very sparse, even just listening to it. Vertical and horizontal organization. Again, listen for things. Is there a melody? Are there a lot of chords? Are things lining up? Use of dynamics, and then repetition, of course. If you're hearing things repeat, patterns in your ear that seem to repeat, it's probably a good indication that these are important structural elements, or perhaps motivic elements. This is taking a step back. As I say at the bottom of the slide, initial observations, these are all things that can help you. Even when the music is like crazy dissonant, no melodies, lots of noise, these are all things that can help you start to come to terms with music. Okay, moving on. I think I've just a couple more slides left. The idea of note groupings, again, I think most of this will seem probably pretty logical for you. We're going to analyze this music. We're looking for how the different pitches are combined, how they're grouped, how they're segmented, how they're organized. And in atonal music, we saw in the example with Webern that he actually laid out a 12 tone rows, actually a sequence of 12 tones. But in atonal music, don't be afraid to look at the microscopic level. Go right in. Is there a consistent use of three pitches, like the 0-1-4? Maybe you'll see that there's a consistent use of even two pitches to outline specific intervals. And this is all fair game. You can really just go deep in and look at the microscopic level. You don't need to look for a scale. You don't need to look for a triad. Just looking at how a couple notes relate can be a key to the entire piece. If you're wondering where to begin with this, like looking for groupings, just start at the beginning, right? In tonal music, for instance, one approach might be to look at the key signature and then perhaps move to a cadence. Usually in tonal music, it's usually really clear where the cadences are. We hear them because of that strong 5-1 motion. So in a tonal piece, I might, you know, look at the key signature and forget about looking at the beginning. Let's just go to a cadence, you know, and confirm the key by looking at the cadence. In atonal music, no. Start right at the beginning. Look at how the notes unfold. Look across bar lines. So you saw probably in the Webern example that the motif structures, they cross bar lines. And look across instruments even. You might find that the motif is distributed over one or two or more instruments. My second bullet point here, okay, we're talking about groupings of notes. Look for things that are repeating, recurring patterns, rhythm patterns are really, really important in atonal music, as it is in tonal music. But again, you're looking for some rhythmic consistency that may help you to group things together. My third bullet point here, let me see, groupings organized melodically or as chords. Again, I've kind of touched on that already. My last point, does a grouping suggest any particular mode or collection? So you will find in atonal music, Perhaps the mode leads you down a different path where you find that the composers, it's not atonal. Maybe it's really modal, like truly quote-unquote modal. So it's maybe in a Dorian mode or a Phrygian mode, a Mixolydian mode. So some of these church modes, which I think, have you all, you've all been introduced to these words, right? It goes back to the Renaissance and these kind of church modes. Maybe octatonic scale. Does anyone know the octatonic scale? Is that a new term? That's a mode that you find in Bartok often. There's lots of examples in Bartok and Stravinsky, where the octatonic or variations on the octatonic mode. Just brief, octatonic scale find the easy way to explain this. It's just a sequence, the interval sequence is semitone, whole tone, semitone, whole tone, semitone, whole tone. So you start on, you know, middle C, and you go up that progression, semitone, whole tone, until you get to the next C, and that forms the octatonic scale. So you might find that you identify some different modes by doing this kind of analysis. Okay, next up, next slide, orchestration. Okay, I'm going to do this analysis of pitch, and you do want to consider how things are orchestrated. Look at where the instruments lie in their register, how are instruments being presented, high register, low register. Look for articulation, dynamics. It could be, for instance, the piano, of course, can play at the same time, high register and low register. And you might see instances where the high register of the piano is combined with perhaps notes in the tenor saxophone, and the low register combined with instruments in the clarinet. So it's possible that, you know, the note groupings might be related by virtue of register. Or by virtue of articulation, all the notes that are staccato start to form a particular motif. These are all, you know, interesting ways of having groupings relate, and we see this in atonal music. In the music, look for the highest and lowest pitches, and also, are there any notes performed in distinctive ways? Rhythmic groupings, perhaps, maybe a repeat of the same orchestration each time. And I think I only have one last slide for you here. It's just about structure and form. My bullet points, I think, say it all. How does the organization of the pitch groupings articulate phrase, structure, and cadence, right? So you've identified the groupings. You start to see how the sets are being constructed. Now you take you can go a little bit deeper and start to ask yourself, well, are some of the groupings used at the end of phrases? Are there specific sets? Maybe there's a 0-1-3 or a 0-1-6 that we see being used only at specific points in the piece. That's really distinctive. These are important things to consider. Do any of the groupings form central units? And then my last point, do the groupings tend to resolve in any way around or related in some way to a single pitch, two or three pitches, pitch classes? And perhaps on that last point, I'll give you a quick example. I'm going to run back to the score. So that last point, I said, you've got some groupings. Do you start to see the groupings relate to any specific central pitch or central idea? If you look at my slide here, you'll see some red. And let's just look at the first five measures. You'll see the red around F sharp in the clarinet. If you want to see how clever Webern was, go back now and compare all of the notes to this F sharp. This is F sharp above middle C, and compare, for example, the tenor saxophone and the violin to the F sharp. And you'll discover that not only are there sets, not only are there 12 tones, but Webern has organized this to be inversionally related around F sharp. So the D flat in the tenor saxophone, if we invert that around the F sharp above middle C, we're going to get the B natural in the violin. It's crazy how he organized this, right? So F sharp to D flat, that's or we can make that a C sharp, so it's a little bit easier for our brain. So it's a perfect fifth. Above F sharp is the first note of the tenor sax. If we go a perfect fifth below the F sharp, of course, we're going to get a B natural, which is the violin. It's like, wow, you organize this extremely systematically. And so that's an example, right, where we might see some symmetry around F sharp. Listen, we better stop there because we're now a little over time. Any comments or questions at this point? I threw a lot at you, and that's yeah. Hopefully you'll get some generalized components there, but we'll revisit this piece in particular and just confirm some of the discoveries we found. And I'm recording this so you can watch it again. Okay. Take care, everyone. I'll see you tomorrow morning.